So some people, especially the heretics, they believed that that's why we call it deism. They say that Jesus was God but not a man like you and me. And some people believed just the opposite. They said Jesus was a man, he was never God. There's a second kind of heresy. He cannot be God because he was a man. He was born in this world, he had a body, and he cannot become God. And the third heresy said that Jesus was a man and God adopted him at the time of his baptism. And just before his crucifixion, the Christ which was descended upon Jesus, Jesus was a man, Christ is divine, Jesus was a man, Christ was the divine personality. So the Christ came upon him at the time of adoption. And they say it is at the time of baptism. That's the reason why, according to them, they say that what? Even God says, he is my beloved son. Okay? God adopted the man Jesus, and Christ descended upon him. And before the crucifixion, Christ ascended, and the man Jesus was crucified. A man called Cerinthus. A lot of people who were believing it in the first century. Adoptionism. That was another kind of heresy. And the Jehovah's Witness, they say, Yahweh is the real God and Jesus was a lesser God and he was the first creation. He was the first creation. Even they are using Colossians chapter 1 verse 15 to tell about them, their understanding. It says he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for in him all things were created. It is clearly written that firstborn. So what they say, Jesus was the firstborn of all creation. That means he was the first creation. Okay? So when you look at it in its original form, a word arche, the first, arche, it is used. Arche, of course, it has a meaning first. But you know that many words in Greek or even in English, they have different meanings. Okay? Arche, maybe you can say it is first. And also another word is there, that it is cause. You can say it is first or the cause. In fact, Paul was saying he is the cause of all creation. And it is, that's how we understand it. For in him all things were created in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, whether the thrones or dominions or principalities and authorities, all things were created through him and for him. It is not that God created, Jehovah God created Jesus and then he created everything. No. Paul says it is for Jesus. It is for the second personality. It is for Jesus everything was created. He was the cause. You understand, my friends? It is not the beginning of every creation or the firstborn. It is the cause. Jesus was the cause of all creation. And he was the, that's why we think about when we are understanding it as the firstborn. And the other kind of heresy, Jehovah's Witness says Yahweh is God and Jesus is not a God. But there are some people who call themselves Jesus only. They say Jesus is God and Yahweh is not God. Jehovah's Witness says, Jehovah is God and Jesus is not God. Jesus only group says, sometimes they are baptizing people in the name of Jesus. in the name of only Jesus. And sometimes even people call me and ask me whether there is any problem in being baptized in the name of Jesus. Even in the Bible, many places it is said that what? They were baptized in the name of Jesus. But what was the commandment of the Lord? He commanded them to baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. That was the commandment of God. Why these people are baptizing only in the name of Jesus? That is the question. They are saying that Jesus is the only God, not the Father and the Holy Spirit. They deny the deity of the Father and the Holy Spirit. They say in heaven there is only Jesus. You are going to see only Jesus, not the Father. Because Jesus is the only God. That's where it becomes a heresy. Otherwise, all these heretic teachings, it is very appealing. But it is like a hook that hooks you and take you to other things. So many times you speak to the Jehovah's Witness, they say, yes, we believe in Jesus Christ. Who said we are not believing in Jesus Christ? He is the Son of God. He has died for our sins. We believe in everything. But they do not believe Jesus as God. Like the people who are Jesus only, they do not say that there is no Father and there is no Son, there is no nothing like that. They say everything is there, but it is Jesus, the only God. Even when we hear Jesus is the only God, there is no problem for us, right? But when we go deep into it, they say Yahweh and Holy Spirit are just a shadow of the real God, Jesus Christ. So I'm going very fast because we have a lot of things to learn in these days. Then I want to say the doctrine of incarnation is the heart of Christian faith. In the heart of biblical revelation, and it is the heart of our faith. This, the doctrine of incarnation is the heart. It is the heart of the biblical revelation. And certainly we need to see that it is the heart of our faith. Jesus is the incarnated word of God. If you do not believe in incarnation according to the revelation of gospel, you are rejecting the credibility of the gospel writers. You need to believe what is written in the gospels. If you do not believe exactly what is written in the gospel about the incarnation of Jesus, you are denying the credibility of the gospel writers. You cannot do that. Including the virgin birth. Many people do not believe in the virgin birth. Virgin birth is the central point or the central theme of incarnation. You understand, my friends? If Jesus was born as an outcome of the relationship with a husband and a wife, then, you know, that Jesus cannot become our Savior. Because if he is born of a man, then he is bound to be a sinful man by birth. The virgin birth is exactly explained, or you know, it is portrayed in different parts of the Bible, Gospels, especially in Matthew chapter 1. Take the book, Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother of Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. It's not child of Joseph, because she found they had been betrothed to Joseph. Before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. Jesus was born of the Holy Spirit. Even verse 20, we see the angel was appearing to Joseph, and the angel said, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. 23 to 25, we see, behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name will be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. When Joseph woke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had borne a son, and he called his name Jesus. So don't think that Jesus was adopted by God at the time of baptism. He was only a man. No, he was born of the Holy Spirit. Even in Luke chapter 1, verse 27, Luke chapter 1, verse 27, to a virgin betrothed to man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary, which is used virgin. She was a virgin. And 31, it is said, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall be called his name Jesus. This was said by, and the angel was saying it to Mary. And 34, and Mary said to the angel, how shall this be, since I have no husband? And the angel said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So Jesus was conceived by, Jesus was, you know, born of the Holy Spirit. Mary was conceived by the Holy Spirit. It's not by a person, a man. So again, Jesus himself called or claimed himself to be God. Or even in the Old Testament, when we read in the Old Testament, we know that there are many prophecies that says about the birth of Jesus Christ. And when we look at it, many times in those prophecies, it's clearly said that Jesus is God. Take the case of Isaiah. Book of Isaiah, chapter 7, verse 14. I'm just reading these passages because you can just check it later. Just write down. I have no time to explain all those things. In book of Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a young woman shall conceive and bear a son, and he shall call his name Emmanuel. A young woman or a virgin shall conceive. And Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, you know, the Messiah will be called as, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, then Mighty God. So the Messiah is not just a messenger of God, he is called Mighty God. It's not just a God, the Mighty God. The same word which is used for Yahweh is used for Messiah in the prophecies. The Son will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He is Everlasting Father. What does it mean? He is the Father. So he is not just the Son. He is the Everlasting Father. The Messiah is the Everlasting Father. He is the Mighty God. So the Son who is born to a virgin is not just Emmanuel. He is called Emmanuel because when he is in this world, the God is with us. That means he is God himself. Okay? Don't think that he is just a messenger. Many people consider Messiah, even at the time of Jesus, many people consider that God will send a Messiah, but though they fail to understand that God is sending God himself. It's not that God is sending an angel. He is God himself. And even in Micah, book of Micah, chapter 5, verse 2, "But you, O Bethlehem Ephrath, who are little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler of Israel, whose origin is from the old, from ancient days." In fact, ancient days is a name that was given for God, Ancient of Days. It is not just for the Messiah, it is for the mighty God, Ancient of Days. So Jesus, the Messiah, is the Ancient of Days. That means he is exactly the God. And even Jesus claimed himself in John, book of John, chapter 4, verse 26, we read verse 25 onwards. "The woman said, 'I know Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will show us all things.' Jesus said to her, 'I who speak to you, I am he.'" See, this place also, in fact, you know, he is using "am." I am he. See, exactly the word which is used for God, he is using it again it here. In chapter 8, verse 58, we have seen earlier that he is using the same word which is used for God. "Before Abraham was, I am." And even in Luke chapter 22, Luke chapter 22, verse 66 to 70, I'll just read that passage very fast. 66, "When the day came, the assembly of the elders of the people gathered together, both chief priests and scribes, and they led him away to their council, and they said, 'If you are the Christ, tell us.' But he said to them, 'If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I ask you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man shall be seated at the right hand of the power of God.'" The right hand of the power of God. The right hand always says that he is equal. See. And Jesus says, "I am equal with God." And that's the reason why they say it is blasphemy. You understand? "And they all said, 'Are you the Son of God then?' And he said to them, 'You say that I am. Are you the Son of God? Because you say that you are going to sit at the right hand of God. That means you are going to equal with God.'" Yes. So Jesus claimed that he is the Messiah and he is God. And also Jesus manifested all the attributes of God. I have no time to explain all those things. Because in the life of Jesus we read, and we will certainly go through that, all those passages, that everywhere we see what all things God was doing, he was doing the same thing. Even he was forgiving the sins. And that's the reason why these people, how can he forgive sins? Because only God can forgive sins. And Jesus was forgiving sins. Okay, I just skipped those passages. And also, if Jesus was a mere man, then he could never die as an atonement. If he was just mere a man, he was just a man. If he was only a man like you and me, then certainly he could not become an atonement for our sins. In Psalms 49, verse 7, Psalms 49, verse 7, "Truly no man can ransom himself or give to God the price of his life." No man can ransom himself or give to God the price of his life. For the ransom of his life is costly and can never suffice. See, truly no man can ransom himself or even in Hebrew, some readings it is no man can ransom his brother. No man can ransom his brother. He cannot ransom himself or he cannot become a ransom for other people. So if I am a man, I cannot give my life as a ransom. Even if I am ready to give my life, if I am a sinner, if I die physically, that doesn't mean that because I die physically, then I am going to be redeemed from the hell. No. I cannot give ransom for my own life. And if I cannot do that, then how can I give it for some other people or my brother? Only if I have extra thing, I can give something to somebody. It doesn't mean if somebody want to help you, at least they need to have two attributes. First of all, suppose I took some money from the bank, and of course, you know that what happens. When I take money from the bank, naturally, all the interest, and finally, I'll be in debt, and I may not be able to pay back the money. And finally, I'm driven out of my house. Right? So when the authorities are coming to my home to take everything and send me out of my house, suppose I have a friend who want to help me. Suppose I owe 100,000 to the bank, and this friend of mine is really a nice person, and he want to help me, and he is ready to help me. He is even ready to die for me. And he say, "Don't worry, my son, my brother. I'm even ready to die for you." Yes, I know that he is even ready to die for him, for me. And when he is there, I'm asking, "Okay, if you are ready to die, you said that you are ready to die for me. Then why don't you just give me 100,000 bucks so that I can be redeemed from these people?" "Oh, I'm sorry. You know, even I owe 2,500,000 to this bank. So if that's the case, do you think that this person can help me?" No. If that person should help me, this person should be a free man. Otherwise, he can never help me. And also, he need extra money to help me. The problem, everybody who lives in the face of this planet Earth, they are all sinners. So even for their own sins, they cannot, it is not, their death is not sufficient even for their own sins. Then how can they pay or become a ransom for my sins? It is impossible. If Jesus was a man, he could never die for me and as an atonement. And Jesus was not a man, he was God. He was not even an angel. See, God was not sending an angel. In Hebrews chapter 2, we see that God made him lesser than the angels. You know why? Because the angels cannot die. Even if God is sending an angel, the angel cannot die for me. So what God did, he himself was coming down. And he came here and he was taking up the penalty of death. The death was inevitable, and the death of a sinless man was inevitable for my redemption. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, it is written, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." You get me, my friends? He who knew no sin, that's important. He who knew no sin. How could Jesus die for me? It's because he was a sinless man. If he knew sin, then he can never die for me. So the doctrine of incarnation portrays Jesus as an undiminished divinity and a perfect humanity. You understand? It is perfectly united in one person. He was God and he was man. And because he was man, I will tell a lot of things later about that kind of things. He was 100% God and he was 100% man. And that made the death of Jesus a ransom for my sins. Incarnation, the doctrine of incarnation, you cannot just avoid it. You cannot just skip the subject. You cannot just overlook it. This is very much important. When we study the life and ministry of Jesus, this is the thing that we need to understand. And now it is time for us to learn the purpose of incarnation. The purpose of incarnation. The purpose. Incarnation is the central focal point of the life of Jesus Christ. This is the purpose of incarnation. Why incarnation was essential? First of all, it was essential to reveal God to man. To reveal God to man. Incarnation made incarnation gave us a revelation. That is, just because Jesus was incarnated or just because he came to a flesh, now we know who God is. That's the reason why I say that Jesus is the revelation of God. Is the revelation of God. If Jesus was not coming to the world, even now, we would have been like the people of the Old Testament. Like reading Jesus as if we are reading a mirror image. Like the prophets were seeing Jesus part by God, part by part. But now it is not like that. The Son revealed Jesus completely. The problem with prophets, they were people of this world. So all they understood about God has the limitation of their human, understanding and even it was revealed, that is true. Unless God reveal himself, we cannot know God. But we have our own limitation to receive the revelation. Don't think that God was not revealing completely to the Old Testament prophets or God was not ready to reveal completely. God was ready to reveal himself to the Old Testament prophets, no problem. But the Old Testament prophets could not receive the revelation because they had human limitations. You understand, my friends?